basics and answer questions around what is a design system and how can you, as you think about the design system that you could potentially invoke or you're already managing at your own place of work, to ensure that you're working on the right parts, applying it to the correct products, and involving the right people. There we go. Shouldn't need to be that close. So again, my name's Nathan. I also tweet at components, so if you're interested in this kind of stuff, I'll often tweet articles and so on to that Twitter address. And so when we think about design systems, the first thing that comes to mind, particularly for folks that are trying to sell design systems internally, is what's the main goal? And when we look at United, a common poster child or whipping post for not cohesive, you think about the different parts of their digital experience and how they don't fit together. I don't need to walk through the massive inconsistency and the lack of cohesiveness that is their product. But now there's this other product team, Google, and what they've done with material design. Very obvious where you, what you need to do with the product, but also as you think about all of their digital, holy crap, what's happening with that? I'm gonna fail with this. Let's move backwards. So you ask yourself, is this cohesive? Material design, which came out roughly 2 to 3 years ago and continues to evolve today, has now made its way through all the Google products. And when you think about the application of a new Google logo and their ability as a company to propagate that sucker out in a day across the entire product portfolio or massive part of their product portfolio, I'm pretty impressed. But as you look at screens like this, you can also sense their application of color, their use of iconography, their placement of UI controls to loosely couple many of their different products, and the way that, particularly for Google, the way that search works in a cohesive way and set your expectations for how the patterns are applied through all the different platforms that they use them on, is that cohesive? I think they are a poster child now of, yeah, that's pretty damn cohesive to me. And so material design was a big deal, and I think this coincides with a lot of teams groups, not just to make design systems and code, but to try and invoke this sense of systematic thought across a broad organization and provoke questions like, how am I going to get all these people to work together? How am I going to get all these products to believe in this thing? And how am I going to work on the right stuff so that we start with a core and begin to build it out over time? Living style guides and these design systems are now everywhere. They seem to have about once a week, some team, I think last week it was like BuzzFeed, they just launched a style guide. We made it public. Come take a look at it. IBM, Code for America, Intuit's Harmony system, Lightning Design System is my personal favorite. But these things are happening all over the place. And when they do happen, I'm going to stop using the clicker. When they do happen, there's a lot of love that happens, right? We launched our Living Style Guide, and it's super awesome. Look at this hard work that we got, right? There's kudos. There's backslapping. There's lots of Twitter loves. There's people saying amazing all over the place because amazing is the key word here. And that seems to be like the mission accomplished. Everyone's sharing their work, and we're learning from each other, which is wonderful. But at the same time, that you got to remember the real mission of design systems. And the real mission of design systems comes from the top down and the bottom up. And from the top down, it's make things cohesive, produce products of quality, deliver products. And from the bottom up, particularly as you're trying to convince different team members, particularly if you're a designer or a UX designer, compadres in the development team, maybe the front-end development team, make our lives efficient, reduce the friction in what we're doing. And so when you think about, is the style guide, the living style guide, actually the aspiration? No, that is just simply a tool. That's an enabler for you to get to a cohesive experience that you produce economically. And so it makes me wonder, what is a design system? And so design systems mean different things to different people. When I think about MailChimp, and I look at MailChimp, I think about a UX designer. He published a number of years ago this set of UI patterns, as he called it. It's really a living style guide. It's a bunch of UI coded components, grid system, typography, tables. Here you can see the feedback component of error, warning, informational message, success message, what have you. And so it can be simply an HTML and CSS playbook used by one designer, developer pair, applied to one product. That's often what we do as design consultants. I run AddThis, and we have projects or engagements with teams where we will create a design and deliver it as a coded design system. That is sort of the last big deliverable so that they can apply it in their situation. But it's one team. To other groups, a design system might be to share for, say, 10 teams. Much like I'll show an example of the array of products we worked on at Marriott a few years ago, where you're trying to bring them together, but you can see the navigation here. This is into its Harmony ecosystem, where we're talking about layouts, nav, content and data, communication, forms and controls. That's a biggie. And as you think about trying to bring teams together, suddenly the specificity and the codedness of this starts to reduce because you're starting to apply it more broadly, maybe across different types of products, different products that aren't willing to play in your same code sandbox. And now if you dig into this one, it's got coded artifacts for some things, but simply spec PDFs or actually red lines of other things because of how much progress they were able to make. Then you think about material design that is endorsed from the top, applies to a massive product portfolio, and is used across so many designers and developers, and it starts to bleed out into a developer community too. All those folks building on Android and so on. The scale of this is vastly different. And the spread of this and your ability to control the application of this is weakened when you're doing that too. And then there's one that's just sort of given away for free. Foundation, Bootstrap is another one. Those are the two leading ones. In fact, everyone always comes to me and says, I want a mini Bootstrap for my team. And I say, that's a great aspiration. Let's talk about what you really need. But this is something that's built that applies to a potentially infinite number of people. The amount of control that Zurb has on how any of those people are creating design is extremely limited, except for how they use it internally at their own agency to deliver it for their clients. And so when you think about the scale of these design systems, it ranges in terms of the number of product teams that you're working on, and also the types of things that you're going to have in it, and the degree of specificity that you're able to encode it, that everybody's going to use that same encoded representation of the system itself. So as I think about what is a design system and I try to think abstractly across all those different things, to me a design system is not just the coded style guide. It's not just the HTML and CSS. We're here at a NoVA UX meetup. So I'm sorry, I'm not going to talk about React.js, which I really want to use on my next project. I'm not going to talk about SAS versus stylus versus less. I'm not going to talk about Bower versus Grunt versus Gulp and how all these different things mix together to create the efficient tooling. I'm not going to talk about code. What I am going to talk about is that to me, a design system is a scalable framework of decisions. Those are all the parts that one or more people have agreed to codify in a way and use consistently, such that they're going to be applied across a product portfolio. Maybe it's one product. Maybe it's simply the project you're delivering. Or maybe it's 100 plus products like you have at Google or IBM or at Capital One if you take Jody's advice and start to work there. And they're built by people. And to me, this makes the problem a lot more challenging. I can create an HTML and CSS toolkit, but when I think about the people that are involved and the people that I need to pair with to make the design, the people I need to collaborate with to influence the design, the people I need to align with to sell the design, that's actually just as much a part of the system. And so that speaks to the fact that there are behaviors involved. These behaviors are the practices you employ. Are you going to have a ruling hand of overlord governance to how you're going to enforce everybody using your design system? Or are you just going to have to rely on sharing and collaboration and hoping for the best and trust in the way that you work with people? And so the first thing is parts. And parts is the easy part, we think. So the challenge that you have when you're creating a design system is you need to answer a few simple questions. And when it comes to parts, what's going to go in it? And you guys have a big list of parts on your table, and we're going to talk about how to use it. But if you want to reference this, I'm going to briefly go through all these things, and then we're going to do an exercise. And when it starts with parts, every design system that I've ever worked on, although there are certainly design systems out there that don't start this way, the ones I've worked on start with three core parts, and they're all part of the visual language: your typography, your color, and your iconography. I've never delivered a system that didn't have all three of these things. And these three things, depending on the choices you make around what typefaces you use, what color palettes you have, and what kind of tone that your iconography sets, comprises the core of the visual language that's going to be propagated throughout your design system. But that's not the only part of a design language. Those are the most common three, but more often the design system applies other things too. So when you think about parts, space is actually the really hard one to control. I'm working on a design today where I'm having to renormalize. We're only building three pages. And the normalization comes in the proper application of space to separate your elements, to create contrast, to create different symmetries and weights in the design. But also motion, imagery, your logo mark, how you're allowed to use the logo, the tone that you have, all those things are often thought of as a design language. And those pieces of the design language, you start to put together. And this reflects oftentimes when people talk about with atomic web design too, the same kind of construction or assembly from your most basic properties into elements like text boxes, buttons, headers, tables, to more complex components. When you start taking those elements and putting them together into a breadcrumb that has multiple links, or a toolbar that has a search and a navigation system with a few menus that are embedded inside it. Or the success messages, which are combinations of color and space and iconography and type. And those ultimately enable you to assemble pages. And a lot of design systems have representative page templates. Others don't. This is Material Design Lite. It's for websites. If you have like a WordPress and you want to create a theme that's based on material design, Google produced a kit that makes it really easy to do so. And part of when you go to their homepage, and you'll see this, they have page templates that reveal to people that don't know all the innards of that design system, what's the kind of things that I can create with this? And you can instantly see the variety, some sort of applications versus basic web layouts, articles for that matter, or dashboards or what have you. Those page templates evoke a sense of understanding, not for you, the designers, who can probably assemble all those things in your head and get away from the abstract and make it practical very quickly, but for the product manager and the executives and the other folks, so they can see what you can produce. Layout systems are also a part of the design system. Are you just going to adopt Bootstrap's grid and take that little chunk, that subsystem out of Bootstrap and inject it into your own? That always ends up being really challenging for me personally. But how do you depict the grid and all of the different columns and responsiveness and gutters and spacing? In the mid-2000s, Yahoo popularized the use of UI patterns within our industry. And so thinking about sign-in, when you think about sign-in, usually it's two fields, right? It's your identity and then it's a password. So how do you apply sign-in? Notice this is an atypical sign-in for me because there's no password field, right? So how is that? That's breaking my sense of what the pattern is. And it's not uncommon for design teams within a broad product portfolio to innovate or experiment with different ways to simplify the process depending on the context. Here, sign into another account, obviously, is a distinct kind of flow. Editorial guidance also winds its way often into design systems. If you think about libraries that a digital team is producing, you have this sometimes sibling editorial guide that sometimes is woven in, sometimes it remains a different site, sometimes influences the types of decisions you make within your own labeling within your design system. This is a screenshot from Redgate Software in the UK, where this was a site that was on, somebody produced a GitHub Pages site that had all the whole word glossary, it had like 1,000 words or something in it. And everybody in the UX team could never remember whether they were supposed to use sign in or login. And she's like, I solved that, it's in here. Well, they didn't know where the hell it was. So, you know what, that speaks to me of a problem of practice and a problem of how you're thinking about architecting people accessing your parts of your system, because this is a part of the system. And lastly, there's the code bits. I said I wasn't gonna talk about all constructing really good modular code, that's a whole different topic, but pairing the examples with the code within a basic set of parts that people use to assemble their experiences. And so there's so many different kinds of parts. You're going to talk about the use of logos and when you're allowed to use them together, or how the use of one logo impairs or enables different things to happen elsewhere on the page. How are you going to systematize your research, your practices like accessibility, SEO, performance, that not just front-end developers need to worry about? Design templates, governance processes, intake, and sort of how you manage your backlog of the system itself, other types of utilities, like helper classes or Salesforce's design tokens, all of those go in to a design system, depending on how you compose it. This is a Think of it as the main navigation or the main topics that the design system we made at Marriott covered about a year and a half to 2 years ago. And so we created a site. It had over 200 pages on it. It had a lot of different, covered a lot of ground, right? And so what did people use? We actually looked at the, by time on site, where people spent most of their time. Not surprisingly, these were the top three. But there were also things that surprised us. We didn't focus much on branding stuff. In fact, we posted a lot of other branding things and generally talked about their different hotel brands. But that ended up being one of the things that people used a lot. Interestingly, as I actually narrow it down into particular topics within each of these categories, you can see the design language is really where they spent a lot of their time. Properly applying icons was a big thing that they worked on. Whereas the UI components, honestly, other than the site navigation, this is a long tail of tiny bits. So if you think about the time they're spending, maybe this is not the right, I don't want to get into an analytics discussion, but this helps me understand the areas that have more or less of a prominence within the organization's conversation. So in order for you to think about what parts go into my design system, that's the first exercise. And so I've got a set of four different things we're going to do with this worksheet. This is the first worksheet. And it's simply a hierarchical assembly of all the different kinds of parts that I just went through examples of, starting with design language, elements, components, patterns, templates, layout systems, all the way down here. You can add your other stuff at the bottom. And what I want you to do is think about your own work. Picture yourself in the product that you're working on, or if you happen to be a design systems engineer like myself, the products that you're actually responsible for getting them all to be cohesive. And what I want you to do is take a look at that sheet, and I want you to immediately cross out the categories that don't matter to you, to your and what you believe your organization values. Any questions? We're going to go through this. It's very simple steps. If you're standing up, hopefully you can get, it's a pair of two sheets. For those of you sitting down, the first thing I want you to do is, across this big thing, cross off all the stuff that doesn't matter to you. Put a big slash through the overall category. Should take just a minute to do this. Look at the headings. Okay? What doesn't matter to you? What will you never put in your system? Somebody said there's nothing to cross off. Thank you for my first talking point. I don't see a lot of slashes yet. Come on, people. Let's think about realistically, in my organization, I'm going to build a design system. It's going to have everything that's not crossed off. Oh, somebody has, I see one with six crosses. That's the current leader I see. Six slashes. Six, all right. Everyone's very quiet, and I see no more slashing happening. All right, the second thing is, I now want you, because nobody slashed, at least of the ones I saw, more than six, which means there's 16 things. So most of these had at least 10 categories that didn't have a slash to them. I want you to circle up to the five most important ones. Can't circle more than five. The most relevant categories to your system. Five categories. Circle the labels or circle next to the label. Circle the big bold type like you see on the screen here where I circled design language. You don't have to do it exactly like that, but you get what I mean. See a lot of circles near the top of the page so far, but not always.
What about data? Information.
I actually consider myself an information architect, but the kind of data you're talking about, I haven't worked on systems like that. So that's not why it's not there. I'd put it in the other category, particularly if you can articulate some of these the topics within data as a category. Visualization is another one that might come up. All right, so we've done two steps. By a show of hands, how many people, can I borrow yours?
Sure.
Because I didn't actually need my own. That's okay. I'll borrow yours. You got an extra? Awesome. Thank you. How many people circled design language? How many people circled design language? Okay, for this second thing, the circling. All right, good. How about UI elements? Show of hands. Strong presence, but not omnipresent. UI components, raise your hand. Strong. UI patterns? Come on, raise your hands. Don't be meek. Good, okay. Page templates? Okay. Layout systems? Okay. Those are all roughly equivalently hand raised. Editorial. Raise your hands high. Let's be proud. I'd actually put that in my top five. Branding. Jody, raise your hand. Goodness sakes. Research and users. Okay. Practices. Interesting. All right. There are fewer hands raised. Coding standards. Fewer hands. Downloads. One or two hands. Getting involved. One hand. About the program. Ooh, Jody, raise your hand. Jody's our archetype here. About the team, the systems team, a few hands, and utilities, a few hands. So that bottom row didn't get a lot of love. But I saw a lot of variety around there, too, which to me speaks to the lack of cohesiveness in terms of everybody's interpretation of what's most important. That is very typical when I go into organizations, that if I'm working with a group of about 15 people, let's say 5 to 7 designers, a few development leads, and some other key people, they end up circling so much random stuff on here that nobody actually agrees on what's important. How many people crossed out design language? How many people crossed out elements? How many people crossed out downloads? Okay. How many people crossed out branding? Yeah, okay. How many people crossed out research and users? Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's okay. We will still love you. How many people crossed out editorial? I don't love you guys at all. No, I'm kidding. All right, so to me, that also makes me think about the fact that there's inconsistency around the boundaries of the system. All right, this is the big one. Check off up to 25 small checkboxes. You can put a check mark next to anything on this page. But you cannot put a check mark next to more than 25 things. These are the most important 25 things, all right? I don't care what you put a check mark next to. You can put them next to a big, bold category label. You can put them next to a second-level checkbox. I don't care. Because the third thing you're going to do is you're going to choose no more than 10 of those by circling those. Because now we're getting close, as you guys work on this, we're getting close to what's most important first. What's the stuff we would work on now? What is our organization that we're serving need? Right? Somebody's going to town in the elements section. I like it. Smattering of language and components. AJ, I hope, is putting research.
I haven't gotten that far yet. Going right out of like 25. All
right. You will most likely use your design system, unless it's a very small product that isn't integrated with any other product in the portfolio, to serve multiple products. So thinking about how you're going to serve, what are the things your system needs in order to be applicable and relevant to a broad array of products? if that makes sense. Well, yeah, that's, you could look at it that way. Because I'll tell a brief story if you guys care about listening while you're working on your worksheets. I went to an organization that was really big, and I had huge aspirations where the design system I told them I wanted to deliver in 6 months had about 40 checkboxes on this page. Yeah, they spent a lot of money. I worked with a lot of people. We did 7 checkboxes in 6 months. It's crazy. And 5 of them were in the design language. Because it's really hard when they have like 150 designers to actually make good decisions around even the top row. I love folks who are actually counting to make sure they didn't go over. There will be penalties. Come on. God, be joking.
I'm in the lens of my position.
Yeah, because I know too much. It doesn't even work. You're lucky. It's gonna see. Oh, thank you.
See, it was meant to be. That's why the pen didn't work.
Thank you. All right, as you're checking things and hopefully circling the most important parts, okay, I want you to go to that second page, and I want you to fill out no more than 10 things here. So if you want to move on to the second page, you can. We're going to work on the left column. Take up to 10 of those things. It could be a tiny checkbox like, I don't know, motion. It could be a big category. However you want to define your system, how you want to define your parts and the things that you're going to work on. It could be, honestly, with design systems, one of the top 10 things we work on early on, color contrast. My God, get that thing right. Because it's inaccessible otherwise. So the mission would be to transition to this second sheet. That first sheet was just sort of a, let's get my, wrap my head around it. The second sheet is what you walk away with that you're going to focus on, that you're going to build something with. So what's your MVP-ish of parts?
What's
yep.
What's the menu
That we haven't, just fill out the part column. Hopefully what I'm doing, and I can give you guys the PDF of these two things, that if you're interested, you can do this exercise with your teams. Okay? Yep.
Okay, so where I work, I have no influence on the branding.
Mm-hmm.
That branding style, you do it, right? So that's why I didn't pick that.
I do. Yes. So what I hear you saying is, unless you are responsible for everything, there are people that have specialized areas of interest that they work on particular parts of the system, or even become responsible for those parts of the system. I'll talk about that in the people section. But in terms of, if I don't own it, does it go into my system? Presupposes that the system is yours. And so what I would react to that with is, who's going to use the system, and what parts do they need to have evident through the system so that they can use them appropriately? When I think about brand, we're working with a high-tech company in North Carolina right now, and they make big boxes of servers and other stuff. And so they have a big branding company that does their marketing material, or big branding chunk of their business. It does the branding, chooses a color palette, chooses a typeface. But we have to translate that for a digital ecosystem of products. And so even though they created a web style guide from the branding group, it's a transformation of what we did to apply that to that digital landscape that it is used by the people creating digital stuff. And so that's becomes the conversation, and that's why, as I'll talk about, brand becomes a team that's involved in what we're making.
So what you're saying is,
Users are the consumers of the system, which are your teams. So what do your teams need? What is the designer working on the My Account page and all the account management tooling that we build in our iOS app? What does that designer need? What does the developer need working on the front end of the corporate website? Those are my customers. Those are the people I serve as a design system. And through them, of course, the customers of the company, the people that pay the company money. But the people I serve are the other teams, in a sense. I'm oftentimes an enterprise capability that multiple teams depend on. So they're all different. Yeah. So the way this practice works is you transition to, you get the people in your group, in your room, to fill out no more than 10 things, and then you talk about those 10 things. So if I could get a volunteer, who wants to rattle off no more than 10 things that they would put in this list? First volunteer, anyone? AJ, just rattle them off.
In no meaningful order, icons, typography, research, form controls, grids, prototyping, download, utilities, coding, and UI.
I don't know what prototyping means. Because was it on the list?
Yeah.
Where does it say prototyping? Under practices? Oh, yeah, I remember that. I like to prototype. Okay, how about another volunteer? Yes.
Logo, identity, dashboard, meaning, is for color, create account, authentication, setting, user needs, tabs, navigation.
Okay. Third volunteer. Yes. Fourth volunteer. Oh, that's awesome. That amplifies its importance. So those lists are different. And you could anecdotally say, they work at different companies, Nathan. They have different missions. Of course they're different. But that is fairly consistent with an in-house team working on a small set of related products when you get the feedback from those folks. And so this becomes a mechanism for you all to talk about what's important, particularly if you do the value column too. And to me, the value column is where it gets really interesting, because I have background in statistics and math, so I love numbers. But we just use tally marks. You say, okay, out of that 10, you get 25 tally marks. Those tally marks correspond to proportion of effort we spend perfecting that particular piece. Think of it as like when you're doing agile sprints and you do the dot voting on different things like stories and so on. Same concept. And suddenly things like color and typography start to bubble up as things that are consistent. If you're talking to Ritz, we actually did this at AddThis, where we had a number of different clients, and we had small groups of members of each of those client teams. And the three people working on the Ritz project all put logo top with like 10 tally marks. Because they all knew with Ritz, they were going through a redesign, logo's now public and so on. But that was the thing that was important to Ritz. Nobody on any other team had logo on their list at all. So that to me represented actually a positive win, that there was some consistency on what people valued that they needed to systematically think about within their design. Before I move on to products, and you think about this parts exercise, or you think about the value of parts and how they can be distinct across even members of your team by discipline, by different products that they work on, and so on. Any questions or comments? One or two questions or comments? All right, I'm going to move on. The next piece is, what products is it for? When you think about a design system and you think about the different kinds of places that people work, when you think about material design, what Google products does material design apply to? All of them? What's that? Gmail. Almost every product they have. You're hedging there. Yeah, I think most people say, yeah, every product they have, right? How about, let's put ourselves in Marriott's mind's eye. What does Marriott's design system apply to? What kind of products do you think they have? Booking, mobile app, what else? And when you say booking, you can book on the mobile app. Online, web booking. Anything else? Kiosks, nice. TVs, when you walk into the courtyard and it has a TV on the wall, right? Does the design system apply to that?
awards program.
That's a divide that most of the time it's hard to leap. I mean, when you think about Marriott's digital ecosystem, that sucker's complex. There's a lot of stuff in there. But how about Redgate Software? A small company makes essentially versioning software for databases. It's really interesting if you actually get them to explain it. It's all about diffs, man. They have a bunch of Windows products. They have a bunch of web products. They have their web marketing site. And so they grappled with this too. What products is this thing for? So you think about Marriott, and when we were working on Marriott 3-ish years ago, they were undergoing a responsive redesign and thinking about a design system. Look at those products. There's actually 6 prominent, or really 5 prominent products: the homepage, hotel property pages, searching for a hotel, booking a hotel room, your account management. You can think about all the other content pages that that 6 team works on. It's like a big grab bag of all sorts of other stuff, and they're different apps. So that product, that design system applies to all those things. And I bet this picture has evolved, particularly in priorities, since then, as they've gone through a year like 2015. Redgate Software started a design system with one thing: their .com marketing site. They had a front-end developer, they had their sort of web dev manager, and they had the guy from the branding department who was responsible for visual design. He's the guy that chooses all the colors and applies them to the web space. And then 2 application product designers are like, that's really cool. Oh, but that mini bootstrap you built totally doesn't apply to us. Our header works different. It needs to have less red in it. It needs to, you know, it needs to really recede because the data of our web apps is really what needs to come to the fore. And so it's a totally different application of the color palette, different componentry. And then they started to bridge those gaps. And then the Windows apps people started to say, oh, wait, we build these apps are embedded in like SQL Server Management Studio. Am I right? Is that the name of that product? Anyway, like really complex stuff that embeds all these web views and so on. So how can you propagate that Redgate identity and that experience so that you can bridge across some of the different web apps that people buy, and more apps, and then more community sites for their people that develop using their software, other kinds of brochures and events, and suddenly this is a really heterogeneous set of things. And so for them, they had a lot of strength, a lot of momentum here. And it became clear that their priority with most of their effort was to bridge the gap or bridge the divide from here to here into the Windows apps. Whereas they couldn't really concentrate too much because there was only 1 out of 10 people in the room that cared about any of this stuff or any of this stuff. Because that was underrepresented. It wasn't part of the mission. And so I asked myself, what would Google do in this situation? Said Gmail, said other kind of products. Since material design is freaking so super awesome and everybody looks at that for, it's a great read. I learned as a designer reading that material design spec. I grew as a designer reading that, so it was awesome. So you ask yourself, what would Google do? And when they underwent this process in 2011 or 12 that became material design, it was called like Project Kennedy, Moonshot, all inspirational. They went and made very deliberate choices around who was in the room. And the people that were in the room were the designers working on a very limited set of products. And when I talked with John Wiley, he was the guy that like coined material design as a term, but I was able to corner him and ask him a bunch of questions. I said, who was in the room? And he rattled off search, mail, maps, Chrome, calendar, not in the room. I said, I use calendar every day. That manages my time. Time is my most precious commodity in my whole life. Calendar's not in the room? No. I think the Android was the other thing. These first 4 plus Android were the designers in the room. And so that to me speaks to the fact that even Google had a good sense of how to tier the flagship products that they focused on versus the secondary ones that they, as their design system began to emerge, they started to involve more relative to the long tail of all the other stuff that if they use material design, great, but I don't have time. I'm projecting John Wiley here. Or whoever, I don't have enough time in my day to deal with this massive array of all these different things, including things like Santa Tracker. You see Santa Tracker anywhere here? Row 4, column 4, that sucker's hot right now, right? Everybody's got to be downloading Santa Tracker because Santa's coming in like a week and a half. But it's going to Star Wars tomorrow. So the thing about design systems, anybody else going to Star Wars tomorrow?
Yeah.
Come on. Who's the biggest? No, we'll talk later about villains. Okay, so the lesson to learn here is identify your core flagship products. What is the stuff that matters the most to you? It might be the stuff that generates the most revenue. Or maybe that thing's not going to get any new development because you don't mess with the beast, but you have a lot of new stuff that you're going to experiment with. And so maybe the emerging products within your portfolio. How do you make decisions around what stuff is in the room versus secondary products, tertiary products, and stuff that seriously you don't even care about? You think it's kind of goofy and silly. And so prioritize those products relative to what's going to be important. And part of the challenge as a person trying to sell design systems internally and evangelize its benefits is I need to fill out this spreadsheet. And this spreadsheet for some organizations can be really hard. You just need to list the products. Who's the product owner, that contact that really owns the backlog, moves things up and down and across sprints in a backlog, the person that makes decisions? Who's the primary designer contact? Who's the primary, usually front-end dev contact? Who's maybe an ops contact, although that doesn't matter as much usually in my work? What kind of experience is it? Line of business does it serve? What platform is it, like web versus native iOS? How important? And then I start to understand, how important is it? How much effort would it be to apply even the basic design language? And how much effort is it to actually redesign it to benefit from the deeper goodness that all of our parts can provide? Some organizations, some big organizations, they look at this spreadsheet and they're like, I can't even imagine what it's like. Like IBM or Capital One or these, some organizations can't fill out this spreadsheet because it's too immense to them. But it helps if you can at least identify two or three or four that will be that flagship part, that core group that you have. And so I wonder, in your particular organization, can you fill out these, it should say product here, not part, that's a typo. But the products, you know, I showed that Marriott slide that had 10 different products. They each have one or more agile teams working on them. Okay, you can look at it as agile teams, you can look at it as product, multiple teams serve a single product. But what products would you have your design system serve? Can you guys fill this out? Does it feel daunting or does it feel easy? Take a moment, try and fill this out. That's the question.
If you have one behemoth of a product, like a EHR or an EMR, that's still valid. So
absolutely. There's certainly a systematic thought, apply a design language, make sure you're consistently using your elements and components and so on. Even for a single product, the design system has significant validity and value. So that thing can be one row. And if you have one row on that, man, the rest, the people part's going to be really easy. I don't think Jody has one row. So if you have more than one product, I challenge you to fill that out. At least start identifying the flagship of maybe some of the secondary products that would be in your list that you think your system's going to apply to. Yes, question in the back. I'm not going to comment on the effectiveness of Marriott because I'm a consultant for them. But
I was working at tax department and based on that, don't take my design. That's my observation that is a lot of internal stuff that I saw. But another observation is about the design. I've got to design you. Your observation is that the majority of people don't understand the precedent that the pure design has had on.
I think the application of responsive or adaptive techniques to enhance the experience, I think, is something that is consistent with systematic thought and sometimes made systematic through a design system. I don't necessarily ascribe those things as being the same, but I think that in the most part, when somebody is familiar with the Google ecosystem, whether they're web-based products or Android devices, it is evident to them how consistent those experiences are now. That's been my experience, and I think... I would agree with that. I have a slide that says, be like Apple was what I heard 7 years ago. Now it's be like Google when you talk about design. So I think that's appropriate. So how many people were able to list five or more products on there? Nice. How many people were able to list 10? Okay. So of the folks that had 10, do you think, if anyone could respond, maybe a volunteer, would you be able to fill out column 2, which identifies the tier or importance of each of those products in terms of engaging those products or ensuring that those products are evoking the design system as a part of their what they deliver for their product delivery? Do you guys think that you could prioritize those? Is that an easy or hard thing to do? I see a thumbs up. Based on the importance that the design system needs to, they need to be a representative product that uses the design system and that it's vital to the business that it use the design system. That's, yeah. It's the same thing with Redgate, for example. One of their Windows products was like some majority proportion of their revenue, right? And so that, but it's really hard to change. And so the conversation with them became not necessarily will they adopt the design system, but what parts of the design system can they really adopt? And the answer became color, buttons, and form controls. If they can do that, even if it's still Arial, we'll take it. Even though on the web and in a lot of the other products that sort of have web-based views, it uses a different typeface. We'll take color and form controls and buttons, and that is a huge win. And so that's in part what I start to do with clients like that is to say, you have a really important product. How can you carve out parts or subsystems of your design system to apply those and inject those into your backlog? With a thumbs up back in the back. So two things come to mind with a situation like that. The first is when you invoke a design system, you go through this formative period where you start it. One of the activities is to discern what the new design language is and what the different parts could be. But then you normalize existing products to show before and after states of if we have products 1, 2, 3, and 4, here's all what they look like now. Here's the concept of the design system applied, maybe some behaviors, maybe implied motion, but at least color and typography and some of the design language. So those four things too. You put them on a wall, that's your story you tell. And so the thing you can't touch is here. It's the first product. It's the big one that's the big breadwinner, say, of your company. And so the story isn't, we're going to work on this in the next 3 months and change everything. The story is, if we want a cohesive journey in our products, that's part of it. And this is what it could look like. Oftentimes, and in fact, 3 or 4 is kind of the magic number of enough products. We'll have sort of the laggard product or the dev team that's under some VP that doesn't want to play. And you do this exercise and you include them because they're really important. And then the other three products start to launch it. And then there becomes this energy of the other three VPs having a lot of success. VP number one doesn't like to be left out in the cold. And so suddenly things start to change. And you have at least a visualization that creates the aspiration of what they could change into. Yeah, and that normalization process, that creation of concepts across products, usually you want to involve the designers of those products to do that stuff together. even if it's just two products. But and that sort of starts to develop a bridge to that team where the designer is playing, the designer is starting to participate. It's a person that's involved. But at the same time, it's not threatening. And it's also not dictating. The part of the message with that before and after is not, we've redesigned your products for you, you don't have to do anything anymore. Because those normalized concepts, the end up resulting design system, isn't it. It's going to iterate and evolve from that because you're going to start to learn what some of the different key constraints are going to be that those products have to have. So you need to play it softly, not as a, we redesigned it, but here's what the future could look like. I'm going to move on to the last piece, and then we can just have a general broad discussion. And that's the people. This is both the hardest and the funnest part. It's the thing where the reward happens when you succeed. And it's the thing that causes all the angst and friction when you don't. We do at AddShapes, we do these post-project surveys. We have a process where we archive the project, we fill out a post-project survey, and then we do a project retrospective. And that survey helps us understand whether or not each of the designers, even each of the different people, felt rewarded about it. And interestingly, when we look at this data over the course of the year, what happens is all the comments, all the text field stuff is, the most rewarding thing I got out of working on this project was I got to work with Chuck. I got to work with Jessica. I got to work with Martin. And it's about the relationships that are created that create the most energy. Design systems is no different because you start to take those people across those disparate areas of the organization, and those are new relationships that you form. And so when I think about design systems, the toughest thing, particularly because people have a tribal allegiance to their own products, is who's going to do the work that is for the common good, that is for this cohesive mission, that is to really motivate it to make everybody efficient. And so there's one model, and I worked within this model when I worked with Sun Microsystems from 2006 to 2010. It was the first massive component library I ever saw. It's still the best one I've ever seen. But it was built by this guy we call the Overlord. And the Overlord was the guy that worked on their .com site, but also built some front end for some applications. He built such a massive library, and he had some sort of helpers on his team, that it had such momentum that it was this train, and if you wanted to publish anything on Sun.com's marketing site or their developer site or these other applications, use the library. And you know what? The Overlord doesn't have time for you? Tough. You still got to use it and figure out how to extend what that person created to use it for your own product. And that doesn't scale anymore. You can't behave like that anymore, right? Because when you go into a company like Marriott, you can't have some design system person that's not even in the team making the booking product that is responsible for, gosh, Marriott, it's billions of dollars of revenue. How much they book per day boggles my mind because it's a massive corporation. You can't have some design system person tout normalized concepts and saying, hey, booking path, do this. They're not going to do it. Capital One's the same way. All these other companies, you can't be an overlord. You can't govern them into submission. And so it speaks to the fact that there are two other models that you can think about that both, usually in large organizations, you need a hybrid of both. And the first is, how do you centralize the effort and invest in a system long-term that is going to serve all these different groups? It becomes an enterprise horizontal service as a design system. And when you go in that centralized model, it's an indication that you're willing to invest and you value these things. Leah Bewley has a Vimeo that's about 50 minutes long that talks about the research she did at Forrester, I think, about the modern UX organization and how organizations sort of evolve, and there is this set of attributes that modern organizations that do UX have. And she said, yes, design systems, and importantly, the staff to maintain them. And when I see this, staff to maintain, I see dollar signs next to that. I see funding. I see VPs saying, part of your job is doing the design system. When I say part of your job, I don't mean Thursday night from 6 to 8. I mean half of your time, 20 hours a week, you are on the design system. And there is not just the declaration of it, but the evidence later on that it wasn't 36 hours of their week was actually working on the new homepage redesign. So they had 4 hours a week they had to do with the design system. And that meant they attended meetings. And that was about it. And so when you think about these centralized teams, they require an investment, but they have a lot of pros. They spread the system broadly because that's part of the focus of why they're being paid to do the work they do. They're freer from the bias of the single behemoth product or whatever their individual product goals are. And they're also watching for opportunities for how to serve, and they have a centralized competency to solicit and manage those requests. The cons of the centralized group, though, is that they're an enterprise service, right? They're not sitting in the agile scrums and the sprint planning and the daily conversations that happen in each one of these product teams. They lack the context. And they also lack power to force all those different designers and developers across those teams to participate. So their influence is impaired. Nevertheless, I see modern organizations doing this. Gina, who works at Salesforce.com and was one of the designers that was responsible for the Salesforce Lightning Design System, it's really a great example if you look at some of the innovative things you're doing, tweeted recently that she actually got her job title changed. I love this. I want to see more of this, right? Because if you believe in design systems, that's a declaration that this entity, this Lightning Design System that they're creating to serve not just their internal teams, but lots of their partner development teams, that is an investment that matters to the organization. Usually, when you think about all the checkboxes that you guys really checked across all those different categories and did so in wildly different ways, you need different skill sets. Notably, I'm not saying job titles, but you need people that can do these things. And to varying degrees, I've done most of these in my career to greater or lesser extents. And so I recognize that when it comes to interaction design, if I was on the team, we'd have some good strength. We probably want one or two more of those. But we're going to need somebody that has this strength too. And so how, when I look across the people in the organization and the types of products that we're going to engage with, how can I achieve a balance here? But at the same time, that balance needs to be coupled with getting shit done. And when I think about getting stuff done, I think about the fact that when you have a design system, it's not a project that you complete by publishing a living style guide. You are creating a product that needs to be maintained over time. And you need to start putting on your hat of, what's the roadmap of the thing that I'm going to do to serve all these other groups? Is there a person that's acting as a product owner? Is there a person that can decisively prioritize things in a backlog that the design system has? Also, what might be a different person, is there an editor-in-chief? Is there somebody that is responsible for not just the words, but the quality of the things that you're publishing that other people use? Who has that decisive say-so? A lot of times, that's the same person. But other times, this person has way too much other stuff to do, and this is somebody else that's been ascribed this particular role. A third thing is, who's the curator? Who's in charge of naming things and organizing things? And whether or not forms and controls is going to be part of your design language, or is it a type of component? Or is it a whole category of components? But then there will also be people on the design system, designers and developers that make stuff, that write stuff, and that participate enough because they have some sort of dotted line relationship with the design system to influence where it's going. And that gets to this other third model that you think about federating out implicit ownership of the design system around your organization, particularly large ones, is who's going to contribute to making things or maybe just influencing things to ensure that the quality is there and that they are able to evangelize outward into all those different product teams. Where, how are you going to involve those people, but even if they're not necessarily on that core team of the design system group? And breaking down those walls creates the sense that this is something that is owned by all. It's designed by, or it's a committee by design to make those decisions in a sense. But at the same time, these are often people that maybe 1 or 2 hours they've really mentally chopped out of their schedule to work on the design system. Or maybe they have a free gap in one of their weeks to write up some guidelines or to create a new type of inline button or variation or animation effect or what have you. And those contributors are important. One group that I worked with, when they thought about the federated roles, not the centralized group, but the federated participants, is they actually looked across their product organization, across their different lines of business, and across the different disciplines to identify essentially director-level design team members of their digital organization. And initially, it was an interaction designer, a visual designer, and a user experience designer. And they had this acronym called UVI, which was U-V-I. And that just was terrible. It's terrible acronym. So one of the things we did was I pitched as I was working with them. I was like, you need to get content in this because content's really important to everybody. And there's not a voice in the system's conversation around content. And ultimately, it became civics. I don't know if that acronym still lives on, but it spoke to me of this cross-disciplinary sense where If you had a content question, this person could always speak authoritatively to it, even though these people were all also able to influence content conversations and were expected to understand what the voice and tone and all the other aspects of that content strategy were. And so I think about these different product groups that are bigger or smaller around an organization, and these design system conversations end up looking like this. There's a person or a team in the middle, but oftentimes getting something into the design system is driven by a director or a designer out here. And you have other people that are influencing that, like a modal. Okay? This group is a line of business. They're starting to incorporate modals a lot. Their modal has this animation where it slides down and smacks into the middle of the page and has a big honking X in the upper right-hand corner. And nobody else's modal behaves like that, looks like that at all. But this team uses a lot of modals in their work. And so they're influencing and they're in the conversation to share ideas. Other people are watching it because maybe we'd adopt that mobile pattern sometime soon. And then honestly, I'm the person in that particular engagement where I'm just facilitating the conversation. Hey, did you talk to that person? Because I saw their design concepts and it's starting to drift a bit. Or, hey, I'm looking at this. I'm looking at your roadmap. You might benefit from what they're doing. And so from a design system perspective, I'm not just a person writing guidelines. I'm essentially, in Malcolm Gladwell's sense, if you're, I forget what book it is, but he talks about the concept of, you know, I think in the tipping point of connectors. And design system participants oftentimes serve that role to facilitate or guide those connections. And also be very comfortable with the fact that other people are going to ignore this conversation. The people in Austin, Texas working on some other product, distant in the organization, that's a tertiary product in your big product spreadsheet, and that's okay. The other thing about people is, I've been talking about a lot of bottom-up conversations, all the different troops on the ground making all the different things and doing the work, doing the good work at the agile team level, right? Designers and developers working on a daily basis. One of the things John Wiley, the material design guy, the first thing out of his mouth in the conversation was like, first things first, what made this work here was that we had support from the top. Once we had enough momentum behind what became material design, he could have a conversation with some secondary product designer, and he would, and that person would be like, well, I want to solve it this way. And it was something that was important for the design system to persist and have greater cohesiveness on. He had the ability to say, well, okay, well, that's fine. I understand your point of view. Do you want to talk to Larry about it? And suddenly the conversation ended because the endorsement in their case of Larry gave them a lot of influence and support. But that also gave them, I don't know if this is a Google case, but in my case, that starts to talk about, when you think top down, you start to talk about not natural connections and collaboration that feels very social, but instead hierarchical. And to me, that speaks to alignment. When you think about design systems, much like you talked about, a lot of the design work, the product design work, is going on with sort of a conversation or a pairing of what might be a product organization, the product managers, if this is how you're organized, the digital designers. You might have tech. If your front-end developers are here, or maybe your front-end developers are here, but if you're doing a design system, there's going to be work done by people across your organization. It's not usually going to emerge out of one single product team. But then you also, as a design system advocate, a person trying to sell this internally, need to create the ammunition and the awareness of what your goals are so that the person at the top of your stack can align and have the necessary enabling conversations with the people across the organization too. I wrote about this and a variety of other topics in a Medium post called Team Models for Scaling of Design Systems. We'll post the slides, I think, Jim, at some point. And also Gina reacted and said, that's really interesting, those models are cool, here's how we do it at Salesforce. And so what it does is it at least provokes some thought around how you can navigate these waters of engaging people. And so that's really, as I'm starting a design system, and if I was to like do an assessment, or I was to drop into a situation, this becomes one of the most important columns too. Who are the people? What type of skill sets are they going to bring to the table? And how are we going to carve out the time necessary to engage the central, to form a centralized team, to get an investment in that, as well as involve the people on the periphery? So that's the parts, the products, and the people that get me started, that hopefully at some point have me in sublime text, invoking some gulp dev process, building components, and spreading that goodness around to the rest of the organization. So that's the talk. I'm curious, are there questions or reactions to what I presented? Yes, on the side.
Yeah, they think of it as like this is a design. One thing we really found is that we kind of did think about what we call it, or meaning the taking design out. One to really understand the stuff. We need engineers to like even design something. The engineer needs to know his work.
So there's a couple of things I can reflect on with what you said, which I think is absolutely correct. The first is sometimes the pursuit of a design system, the dimensions might not include dev. I'll be honest, at Marriott, we never built a front-end living style guide. I really regret it. But they didn't. That didn't necessarily gate successes that we had with the system itself. And that was a boundary within that organization that was one that we didn't overcome. But at the same time, that doesn't mean that it's wrong. The other thing that I've seen is that the most effective teams figure out how to bridge that at the start. And so I think about my experience. I was a consultant with eBay in like 2008. And they had a design organization that was growing. They built this pattern library. And the pattern library had all sorts of elements and components, sort of. And they had their own taxonomy, their own structure to it all. And on the other side, when I arrived, I was like, what is this thing? $10 million invested with their front end team to build their component library. Pattern library, component library. Taxonomies didn't map together at all. And so I hope that they both had a thing called button. But they might not have had a thing called modal in both of the places. And so the way that they were creating this thought process of the things they were building is totally disjoint. That's like the worst that I would see it. Even though, did their component library net a lot of value for all the developers? Totally. Did their design pattern library net value for their designers? Probably. But that it was a missed opportunity to bridge that gap. So one of the things that I try to do is when you develop, if you remember me telling that story, those normalized concepts, let's build some of those suckers in code and show, even if it's a one-week exercise, building those things starts to help you understand a lot of the levers you turn to make decisions around how the parts are defined. What colors are we going to use? Are we going to use just the big saturated set, or are we going to use tints of all those? And what is tint? See how these require tints. These just use the basic color palette. And it invokes those conversations that are really productive. So that's the bridging and the naming of the thing and the taxonomies of the thing that can be hard. Thanks for that. Another one, AJ? I don't personally, my team does. All right, well, but thank you, AJ, for giving me the opportunity to show this slide. So we do a lot of coaching and workshops and projects. But I think what you're asking about is the topics and the workshops that we do. And I tend to group them into three big kinds of chunks. The first is just introduce what a design system is. Go through exercises like this and help people understand what are the impacts and print priorities and objectives of what pursuing a design system is all about. It's sort of fundamentals. The next part is what I'd call modular web design. Adam, you're talking about naming things. Brad Frost, Atomic Web Design, is by far the most prominent description of how to break down a design into all its parts and figure out efficient ways to reassemble them. And so we do workshops that actually cut up all the screens, which it's really easy to learn. I have a Medium post if you want to do it with your own team. But essentially, you get a group together for 2 or 3 hours, you cut up all your screens, and suddenly on the wall, you've got an organized component library. And that helps sell the idea because everybody can just see it. And so those are the kinds of things that we teach. That bridges to, okay, how are we going to not just draw rectangles on paper, but actually draw rectangles with markup and SAS or CSS and so on. And then the third thing is helping teams learn how do you transition from the thing you built, all those modular parts, to a product you sustain. And that is just applying product management principles to running a design system and the specific challenges you have to manage it over time. Thanks, AJ. Other questions or reactions? Crestfallen disappointments or wins that you've had before? Yeah.
Maybe this is touching on a lot of points, but
I've been involved in a couple of large redesign projects where the main goal was not to build the design system, but someone had heard the phrase, and so it's kind of glommed into the requirements. And it didn't really, you don't really have the momentum to make really that happen in a successful way. Well, I didn't manage to get those two projects, but you managed to make it work in like just kind of bringing it alongside some other project and like saying, well, let's start to build the design system using this as the figurehead.
So there are companies that come to us and say, we're building a bunch of products. They're not cohesive. We're not efficient. We need to build a system to improve upon those two key facets. There are other projects where they're like, we need to responsibly redesign our website. And so we don't even sell the design system as something on the SOW. But it's interesting as we go through our little design sprints and we progressively deliver stuff over 3 to 4 months, say, the project engagement, there's this point at about sprint 4 or 5 where we do a lot of our work in code, where you see the outcomes of these components we're building, and they see page types that are constructed that we've really grounded the sprints on. But then there's a point where our deliverables starts to look like it's living style guide, and it has sections called page types and components and visual style and so on. We didn't ask for permission to create a design system. It's just the way that we structured delivering our work and really slicing up and making all of our different pieces that we're going to deliver atomic. And so the goal for them wasn't, and now we have something we're going to have as this ongoing program of a design system. They were just going to launch a responsive redesign of a product they already had. But that moment where we really shifted the deliverable to make it, evident the system, opened their eyes and made it very clear the bridge that was going to be from this design vendor to their Drupal developers that needed to hopefully not change a lot of markup, but borrow almost all the styles that we're creating. And it created the for the dev team an understanding of how to chop up their work in congruence with how we're chopping up ours. So to me, that I didn't ask for permission to do that, but that was a good win that we had. I'll contrast that with the same project. They're like, this is so awesome. We need a design system. And then I started to put my consultant hat on and say, okay, well, if you're going to do a design system, here are all the things that you're lagging with that you'd have to change behaviorally. And then they reacted with, why are you telling us how we suck? And that was a really difficult lesson for me to learn, because I've seen other teams succeed with this. I'm a big believer. I'm an advocate, obviously. But to have that, people don't want to hear that they're doing it wrong. And so to me, the better path would have been if there was a second and a third product that we were going to work on with them, continue to show them the benefits as we worked on those of how the things bridge together. And then suddenly, a year from then, there's 7 products that are all reliant upon this core. It's actually a code repository of a system that, for us, we invoke as submodules into each of the different products. So that's a softer way to get there without asking for permission. But obviously, I tripped and I made mistakes along the way. Another comment?
Have you had a chance to design, develop, and deploy the design system in an application setting in an iterative way, rather than, you know, you snap the whole thing together and try to get
Design systems that we've worked on commonly span websites and web apps. Sometimes we've created design systems that aren't coded artifacts for Android and iOS applications. Like Cisco had in 2011, where they went from 7 to 40 apps in their app store, right? And so they had all these random apps mobile, and they had all these panels coming in from the left-hand side. As you drill deeper in a hierarchy, they come in from the right, by the way. And so things like that, where we created systems for those people to benefit from it. One of the things I advocate for, though, is not a big bang reveal. If you remember the 1, 2, 3, 4, the before and afters of the 4 flagship products, 2 of those products had enough momentum and sort of legitimacy with their pursuit that they started to integrate changes into sprints of their products to change type, subtly change their color, start to peel apart some of those subsystems chunks of their design system, like on that set of checkboxes on that worksheet, and just do it over time, such that they weren't relying on some big bang. Marriott, different, right? They have a whole suite of integrated paths, the hotel pages and the reservation path to book your hotel room and your account management for your rewards loyalty program. They turned some of those on at different times, but there was also the conversation of when do we flick the switch in production to make evident all those things so that you don't create discontinuities in the experience. And so sometimes the conversation isn't, well, I need to go with for a big bang with everybody, but it's how can I get on some of those different roadmaps and have visibility so that they know when they can turn switches for big chunks of it together. Does that make sense? Okay. Yep. Motion? Did you say motion?
Yes.
Good for you. Enterprise meaning web-based applications? So I'm not an expert on motion. There are definitely some great motion experts out there, and the teams that I've seen effectively integrate motion into their design systems are ones where there is at least one, but even better, two designers on the team that are really literate with motion design. I had things like information architecture, content strategy, and other kinds of disciplines. To me, motion design, you can look at that as a discipline almost because of how deep that knowledge can be. And so I've seen at one of my clients making two different web apps, you had one person that was really strong on it, one person that was moderately strong on it, and that started to influence it. Did they have a big motion chapter in their design system living style guide? No. But they were definitely having conversations across different product groups that were influencing some commonality that they were pursuing. So that's about the extent I've seen with motion, but that, to me, isn't as strongly embedded as most of those other disciplines. Mm-hmm. Any other comments? Yeah, Jody.
So I'm curious how you focused or redirected a conversation with a stakeholder who all of a sudden said everything looks the same.
So I think a lot of us have dealt with that. I just was working on a project that I thought was going to take about 80 hours, and it took about 6 because I had a design system. And one of the reactions of a person a bunch of people I've worked with a lot, but the stakeholder for this project, which is how do I, as a new employee, get a bunch of new equipment, my laptop and all my other stuff. Simple flow. I think it was phone, laptop, and display. You had to make 3 choices. And on your phone, you did get to choose color, like gold versus silver or whatever. And so I was like, oh my gosh, these requirements are far easier than we thought. And so her reaction was, but that big blue button, the spare sort of really simple, flat design, but the big blue button is just really in my face. Everybody else what I leaned on was everybody else admitting that's not the problem we're solving and being the advocates for me, but also helping educate those folks that innovation doesn't necessarily require changes to a visual language. Those visual language pieces, color and type, are simply tools that we have to create experiences that solve problems. And the problem isn't, is the big blue button different? The problem is, can my prospective employees get their equipment really easily and reduce the friction so that when they show up, they have a package when they arrive at orientation, has their stuff. And so I try to redirect the conversation from making choices that are inconsistent to what are the problems we're solving. And I think another aspect of that, though, is as a design system person, you need to be open to the extensions of and the exceptions of work that happens that uses the design system as a base. So if you create an atmosphere that you're not allowed to extend it, then it's only going to work for the product you've already applied it to. And if you're not allowed to create exceptions, then you're going to have to be visible everywhere and make all the decisions. Neither of those is realistic. And so you have to be cognizant of where to make those trade-offs too. You might have the campaign mini site that is sort of the separate sibling site to your overall marketing experience that needs to have a new visual system or change aspects of it. That's not going to change the flagship and secondary product set anyway. It's not going to let it go. So that's another thing that I do. What's that? Yes, exactly. Choose your battle. Other comments or questions. Yeah, in the side.
In a way of saying, like, there's a user benefit though, because there's consistency, so they'll understand. They, I know that like, I get that, but there is that, and then there's also that you can build, like, make them part of that discussion, so they don't feel like you're handing it to them. This way, it's kind of like, all right, now you're doing this with us. Granted, you know, do that all the time, but.
I think you're right, and the more challenging conversation isn't with the distant stakeholder that you don't engage with much. The challenging one is the secondary product designer that's a little bit outside the periphery of the core group that's making all the big calls on what's our saturated red and blue at Capital One, right? And so, interestingly, one of the things John Wiley also has mentioned in that conversation was the more they were willing to engage and use the system, and the more they were actively engaged in the conversations around the system, actually the more leeway they got to make exceptions or to drift more, to extend it and change it and reform it in ways that suit them too. And so that's another thing where if they really are, if another designer is expressing that need to be different, try to bring them in the fold and make them a contributor so that your goals start to merge rather than be separate. One last comment before we conclude. Anyone else? Yeah.
A lot of this started from the or companies with a large budget of research, making people and projects or products. Is there a single reason that I see a huge familiar base in their bootstrap? Is there a single resource for entrepreneurs and startups to apply non-existent content to a single product? You know, if they're starting out to educate.
Yeah, Bootstrap is probably a great starting point, actually, because that is the phrase that people that are less literate in design systems but see the benefit of that. I want to make a mini Bootstrap for my team, is what I hear. Also, Bootstrap may or may not apply the right visual language or maybe too hard to override to customize for a client that I had this summer. They were like, we're going to use Bootstrap. I was like, those patterns don't apply at all in terms of the layout system and so on. But at least it creates the model by which they can understand the structure of the decision making they need to have. I need to focus on color palette. I need to focus on grids and columns and so on, and or my app or what have you. And so it becomes an implied teaching tool because it makes the great thing about these design system and living style guide sites is they make evident how everything's related and interdependent with each other. And so, yeah, that's where I would forward those kind of folks. Yeah. Thank you so much. You've been a good audience, good questions, and I hope you have some tools to bring back.